Hello and welcome to the SAP and Azure Synapse Analytics Integration Series, Part 3. In this session, we will focus on how to ingest the data from the SAP into Azure Synapse Analytics using the Synapse pipelines. Also, we will look at how to transform the data, perform ETL and ETL, ELT sort of operations using mapping data flows. We will also look into some of the key capabilities of the mapping data flows within the Synapse pipelines. Let's get started, folks. Let's start by looking at how to ingest the data from SAP into Azure Data Lake storage using Azure Synapse Analytics pipelines. I have already logged into Azure portal and have launched the Azure Synapse Analytics Studio. From the Synapse Analytics Studio, I would select the Integrate Hub from the left navigation pane. You can see the list of pipelines which you have previously created from the Pipelines tab. If you would like to create a new pipeline, just click on these three dots and click on the new pipeline and give necessary settings. As I have previously created SAP data ingest pipeline, I would simply select that and walk you through how to add the copy activities. There are some list of copy activities you can see already been included in this canvas. For example, ACDOCA table copy, this ingests the data from the ACDOCA table into Azure Data Lake storage. There are a few other tables as well, which I have ingested according to my requirement. In order to add the copy activity, you need to select the move and transform and drag and drop the copy data activity into your canvas. Once you select the activity, it would immediately pop up with the necessary settings associated with that activity. For example, if I select VBRK table copy activity, I can see the previously created the configurations. Let's start with general settings where you can see the name for the copy activity as VBRK table copy, description as copy table VBRK, and timeout. This basically ensures that the copy activity runs for a specific amount of time. If the job runs beyond this configured time, then the job would be automatically killed. Retry, which allows you to retry your activity for X number of times. The retry interval basically helps you to specify the amount of time you would like to wait before the retry happens. There are additional settings such as secure output, secure input, which allows you to basically not write the data while the data is being moved into the logs. From the key thing here is you need to configure the source, which is in our case SAP, and sync as the data lake storage, as the data is coming from SAP and going into the data lake storage. From the source settings, I have to first configure the source dataset. You can either select an existing dataset from the list, or you can create a new dataset as well by clicking on that new button. You can search for SAP, where you can see various different connectors for the SAP as the source. In my case, I have selected SAP tables connector, which would allow me to be able to read the data from a specific table and ingest it into the source's destination system. There are many other kind of connectors as well. According to your need, you can choose one. I'll just quickly show you what kind of settings goes into that SAP table connector by clicking on that edit button. You need to first configure the link service. Think about linked service as if it's the properties associated with the connection for the underlying storage platform. So I have given a name for my link service and the integration runtime. In this case, I have used SHIIR, which stands for Self-Hosted Integration Runtime, which allows you to connect to the underlying source system and then retrieve the data. Imagine when if you are running your SAP platform on your on-premises data centers or even on the cloud, that you can leverage on the SHIIR. I have selected logon type as application server and given some additional settings such as server name, system number, client ID, and the credentials required for me to be able to connect to the underlying source system. Once I have fully configured and tested the connection, then I can select the table name and pass any additional parameters as well. Once you have given the source dataset, then you need to pass the row count in order to limit how many records you want to retrieve from the source system. Imagine there can be like hundreds of columns within your table, so you may not be interested in with all those columns, so you can select the specific columns which you are interested in using this table fields. You can also push down the predicate where class predicate by using the table options where you can pass down the where class filter to the source itself. There is custom function module which actually allows you to be able to write some customized sort of data ingestion scenarios where you don't have a specific column to filter the data on. You can implement this custom function module. Partition option on the other hand will allow you to run parallel data ingestion by partitioning the data on a calendar month or year or day kind of scenario. You can also pass the column delimiters and so on. From this sync dataset configurations, I would select I would select the data lake storage as the sync. Let me quickly walk you through how the settings would look like for the data lake storage dataset. The Parquet VBRK dataset, I have created a link service. Again, this allows the system to be able to connect to the underlying source system, which is data lake storage in this case. I have given a name for this linked service and then selected as auto resolve integration runtime, leaving it to the system to decide which integration runtime is appropriate to connect to the underlying system. Again, I'm passing the managed identity. This allows the pipelines to be able to connect and write the data into the data lake storage. On top of it, I would pass some additional configurations as well, such as URL for the data lake storage. You can pass the container name and the path for your directory where you want to write this table. The good thing about the Parquet file format is this is one of the standard kind of data formats used in the big data platforms, which is a columnar store. It has got the schema predefined into the storage files itself, so you need not have to pass the schema manually in order to read the data. Also, it would does the compression effectively. You have the choice of compression techniques. In my case, I have chosen the Snappy, which is a powerful compression technique, which would allow you to compress the data anywhere between 3 to 9 times, depending upon the nature of the data itself. Now that we have seen the configurations required for the copy activity, you can also give some additional settings as well, such as mapping. This is very interesting kind of settings where you can map the source columns with the destination columns and see the data types according to those underlying storage platforms. There are some additional settings such as data integration units. This tells how many DIUs this job can use, and the copy parallelism and so on. You can also pass some parameters dynamically to this pipeline as well through the user properties tab. Now that we have understood the necessary configurations for the copy activity, you can now validate your pipeline to see if there are any errors. If the validation is successful, then you can either run it on the debug mode, which would allow you to see some sample outputs and make sure that the job is working perfectly. Finally, you can also trigger this pipeline using add trigger. You can create a periodic schedule using this new button. Otherwise, you can manually trigger this pipeline on an on-demand basis. I have previously clicked on the trigger now, which actually moved the data from SAP into the Data Lake storage. Let's move on to our next step, where we can review how to transform the data using the mapping data flows within the Synapse pipelines. So far, we have seen how easy it is to ingest the data from SAP into Azure Data Lake storage using Azure Synapse Analytics pipelines. Now, let's review how to transform the data using mapping data flows. I have previously created a mapping data flow pipeline, customers' total revenue. In this pipeline, I have added a mapping data flow activity. You can simply drag and drop the data flow activity onto the canvas and start configuring the activity. In an existing mapping data flow, I have just given the name for under the general settings and few other configurations you can configure according to your requirement. Underneath the settings tab, I have previously created a data flow pipeline. I will quickly open it and show you the different transformations which I have already created. In the data flow canvas, as you can see, I have configured two different source systems to read the data from the SAP tables written into Azure Data Lake storage. The tables called VBRK and BUT000. All that I need to do is give appropriate configurations for the source activity, such as the dataset name and so on. Once I have configured both the sources, then I will quickly add a join operation in order to join these two files using the join activity. Inside the join activity, I can select the left table and the right table, and I can also select the join type, such as outer join, inner join, and so on. Once you select the join type, you can also pass the join condition on the columns you would like to join these two files. And then I'm aggregating the data by using a group by operation on specific column names. According to your business need, you can choose the right columns and the group by operation as well. Finally, I'm writing the data into SQL dedicated pools by configuring the SQL dedicated pool specific data set, which writes into a specific table. As you have seen, it is quite easy to transform the data at scale using the mapping data flows. You can find out most of the common sort of transformations you would typically encounter on a daily basis while performing ETL and ELT kind of operations, such as joins, conditional splits, lookups, and few other aggregate kind of operations as well, such as ranking and so on. Filtering, etc. So this concludes how easy it is to transform the data using the mapping data flows. To summarize, in this session, we have learned how to ingest the data from SAP into Azure Data Lake storage using Synapse Analytics pipelines, and how to transform the data with the UI-based transformational capabilities using mapping data flows. We have not written a single line of code, but we are able to ingest and transform the data at scale from SAP into Azure using Azure Synapse Analytics. In the next session, we will learn how to write SQL queries using the SQL notebooks and how to transform, how to apply custom transformations using Spark notebooks as well. Thank you, folks. See you all in the next session.